Too high, so high, I feel like I'm about to die. Too high, so high. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, family. Welcome, welcome, welcome to the Mental House with me, your host, Khadijah. I'm not going to be on here with this video, I don't think, too long, family, but because it's so damn crazy, I decided I got to share this with my family. Y'all just got to hear this. And this is actually the other day, a friend of the little crazy dude that went into the church, what is his name, Dillon Roof? The one that went into the church and bombed those innocent people while they were during prayer service. His friend was sentenced to jail. And y'all might be like, what am I talking about? Let me just read this story to you because it'll probably make a little bit more sense. And do you know, well, I can talk about that in a second. Because somebody actually had the nerve to get mad about this damn article and about this young man being sentenced. And that's why I always say that, you know, when I'm dealing with, and there's no disrespect to anybody, usually when I'm dealing with Caucasian people, you know, I have to, I'm apprehensive. And I would be a fool not to be, because we don't have a history of oppressing and killing and doing all kinds of evil, diabolical things to you. You have a history, a well-known documented history, and it continues to go on what you continue to do to us. Okay, so, you know, it's really ridiculous, I think, for any black person to sit there and try to explain or try to worry about somebody's feelings when it comes to something as sensitive as this right here. I always say, and I've said it in prior videos years and years back, I teach my children that to look out for snakes, okay? Now, I don't have time right away to figure out what's a good snake or what's a bad snake or what's a garden snake, and eventually I learn those things. But the first thing I need to concentrate on is snakes bite, okay? And if, as a black child, if I don't teach my child that, then I think I've done my child a disservice. And I really don't care what anybody that is not a black person or a person that has to live under the dominant society, I really don't even care what you think about it. So you can just save that. Save that to somebody. Beat me with a different stick, because that stick definitely is not going to work. So what I want to do is I want to share this story with you about this nut named Joseph Meeks, and how he's like, dude, really? You know, really? Say, and let me just read this story to you. And this is out of Charleston, South Carolina. Of course, this article is from the New York Times. His ass is going to prison. Joseph C. Meek Jr., a friend of Dillon S. Roof, who spent time with him in the weeks before 9 people were killed at the Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church here. And he was sentenced to 27 months in prison for hampering and misleading the federal authorities in the aftermath of Madman Roof's racist massacre. I won't even put Mr. in front of his name. The punishment handed down by Judge Richard M. Gurgel of Federal District Court was at the low end of the sentencing guidelines. Are you surprised? Which called for Meek to spend from 27 to 33 months in prison. The months that he spent in the county jail after his arrest will count towards his sentence. Isn't that something? Okay. While they steady throwing black people time like they're giving out treats. You know, 50 years here. I'm seeing them give little kids, young people, 19 years old, 50 years, 25 years for being accessories. for being in a car with a friend that might have had drugs and you didn't know, and that person really didn't know. So, you know, just this cesspool of madness. I keep saying, we got to get a plan. Don't have a plan. You're going to plan to fail. Fail to plan to fail. Before the sentence was announced, a tearful Meeks said he was not sure whether he would survive prison. Should have thought about that when they was thinking about planning to gun down black people in church. And he apologized to the family members of Roof's victims, some of whom was gathered at the hearing. And I hope they didn't start talking Jesus stuff. And, you know, I don't even want to hear that. I'm really sorry. A lot of innocent lives were taken. No, you sorry because you got caught and you going to jail. Who had previously expressed remorse in a handwritten letter in which he asked for forgiveness. But Judge Jurgel, speaking at a hearing that lasted more than 2 hours, said that Meeks' crimes warranted prison. The danger is he exposed to the community is extraordinary. I'm glad the judge had the foresight to at least put him in jail. Meeks' lawyer, Deborah Barbier, expressed concern that her client will be forced to spend his sentence in solitary confinement because of security risks. Judge Jurgel said the Federal Bureau of Prisons could be trusted to protect him. It's an odd inverse logic that I should not incarcerate him because inmates think so lowly of him. Ain't that a bitch? It's an odd inverse logic that I should not incarcerate him because inmates think so lowly of him. Isn't white privilege something? Y'all is just too crazy. Your narcissistic, crazy asses gotta get stopped. Cause your mind needs to be shook like you shake a tree. Because the nerve of her, after this young man was, he had the ability to stop that massacre. He had the ability to stop the mayhem, and he allowed his mentally ill friend, cause I definitely know the guy's crazy. He's mentally ill, but he got to pay for what his mentally ill self did. But your friend, who was sitting back on this information, he went to sleep at night. He got up and ate the next day, and this went on for a whole week before Dillon decided to do what he did. And all that time, this idiot never said anything. Meek pleaded guilty last April to 2 federal counts related to the truthfulness of his responses to the FBI in interviews shortly after the shooting on June 17, 2015. Misprison of a felony and making a false statement to law enforcement, that was his charge. Misprison refers to the failure to report a known crime. The government did not prosecute Meek for failing to disclose knowledge of Ruth's plans to attack the church, although it asserted in court filings that his silence did deprive law enforcement the opportunity to intervene. During the night of drinking and drug use, about a week before the shootings, Ruth told Meek that he wanted to kill black people at a historic African Methodist Episcopal church in Charleston in order to start a race riot, according to FBI summaries of interviews with him. Mr. Meek was concerned enough to hide Mr. Roof's handgun after he fell asleep, but later returned it to him and did not report the threat to law enforcement. Certainly, defendant's failure to make an early report is tragic and deeply regrettable, but his failure to report was not a violation of federal criminal law, Judge Gergel wrote last week in an order that denied prosecutors' request to give Meeks a longer term than recommended in the sentencing guidelines. Mrs. Barbier said in presenting filings that it was hypocritical and disingenuous for prosecutors to suggest that Meek was somehow to blame for the killings. Joey's failure to appreciate the seriousness of Ruth's statements is not unusual in today's shock value culture, she wrote. Her name is Joseph Barbier. Now, for any of y'all down in that town, this is insane. The court on Tuesday, a defense witness said that Meeks' connection to the Charleston massacre would make him high-value target in prison. He'll have to be kept separate from other inmates, not because of what he did, but because he has some relationship to the hideous crimes, said the witness, James Aiken, a former warden for the South Carolina prison system. The case against Meek matters both as a lesson about reporting suspicions and for the insight he provides into Ruth, who represented himself at times at the trial and blocked the admission of any evidence about his background or psychology. As a result, the trial in December and January, which ended in the death sentence for Mr. Ruth, provided little information about what may have incited him to act so violently on his racist beliefs. He's probably a Manchurian candidate. Mr. Meek has said in various law enforcement interviews and court appearances that he first met Ruth, who grew up near Columbia, South Carolina, in middle school. They largely lost touch when Ruth moved away, but reconnected via Facebook on May 22, 2015, less than a month before the massacre. Ruth began hanging out at the trailer, so they trailer trash, where Meek lived with his girlfriend and other family members. One night in early June, after consuming vodka, marijuana, and cocaine, Ruth told Meek of his support for segregation and his desire to do something big and put South Carolina on the map. Meek told FBI he said that he had been planning the attack for 6 months and that he hoped to carry it out on a Wednesday because fewer people would be at church. He told Meek that he would then kill himself. But he didn't, remember, because the police picked him up and took him to Burger King. Meek dismissed the seriousness and did not notify authorities. Meek learned about the shooting soon after Dillon Ruth opened fire and discussed his fears with a friend, Dalton Tyler, telling him not to contact the police. Mr. Tyler held off that night, but the next morning, as a photograph of Ruth from a church security camera began circulating, Mr. Tyler became the first person to call police tip line and to identify the gunman. According to the search warrant, Mr. Tyler became the first person to call the police tip line to identify the gunman, according to the search warrant. Excuse me. Mr. Ruth was arrested later that morning in North Carolina with the murder weapon in the backseat. In his initial FBI interview, Mr. Meek denied having known Ruth's plans and said that Ruth had not spoken of a target for his attack, according to the Assistant United States Attorney Julius Richardson. But in a second interview, Meek admitted that he had lied, according to FBI synopsis of the session. He also admitted that on the night of the shootings, after concluding that Mr. Ruth was responsible for the attack, he told others not to contact law enforcement. In the conversations with investigators, he didn't even care to all these damn people sitting in church, shot down. See, this is evil. Just evil at its best. In the conversations with investigators, Meek described Ruth as a shy former altar boy who did not have many friends but was not a social misfit. His parents, who were divorced, lived in houses with swimming pools and gave him almost anything he wanted, Meek said. He did not perceive Ruth as depressed or having an anger problem. When Mr. Meek was first charged and agreed to a plea deal, the expectation was that he would testify in Mr. Ruth's trial about the killer's premeditation and planning. But the government's case on that score was strong without Meek, and neither side called him as a witness. Mr. Richardson declined to comment on Tuesday, as did relatives of Ruth's victims who attended the sentencing. Meek, who will remain free on bond until he reports to prison, has told authorities that he thinks about the carnage every day and that he has trouble sleeping nearly 2 years after Ruth's killing spree. I truly, in my heart, didn't take him seriously, and I wish I would have. Meek, a 10th grade dropout who worked in construction, said in a written statement, I didn't believe he could do something so awful and cruel. But he told you. I mean, you didn't believe he would do it, but somebody tells you something that drawn out, that specific, and you don't think they're going to do it, you need to be in jail. Because you know what? You're not using a very good spirit of discernment. You know, and you didn't. So I don't feel sorry for you at all. You know, I really don't. Wait a minute, y'all. 1 second. Anyways, I'm sorry. I just think that let that be a lesson to anyone out there that would be so ridiculous, that would to hear somebody say something so hideous and you don't take them serious. Because it kind of reminds me of, again, like the cesspool of the evil devils, black devils. These were black devils. That this is the second time I've heard. And actually, one time I was involved with a story like a 15-year-old girl getting raped by all those guys, and they put it live on Facebook. Well, when I was working back here with the aldermen a few years ago, in my neighborhood, in my district, there was a 12-year-old girl who had been molested by 38 to 40 men. Let me make sure I get it right. Yeah. 38 to 40 men, with the oldest one being over 40 and the younger ones being in their teens. And the alderman and I mean, we work vigorously. I mean, overnight, vigorously canvassing the neighborhoods, trying to get as much information as we possibly could about what went down in this house that these people would allow this girl who stayed with her grandmother to be molested by that many young men. And this went on. This was going on all day long and all evening long. And you know what the catch to the whole thing was? The sad part about it is the girl had AIDS. She was born with AIDS. And so all of those guys, that was a lot of the reason why a lot of them turned themselves in as well. First they thought it was a hoax. They realized that it wasn't. And so that was just insane. Now, I don't know what the big thing now is to film this kind of stuff. But you might as well just take yourself to jail, go tell the police that you raped somebody and that you're insane, that you're sick, and you need help, you're in need of a doctor, Because to do something that repulsive and then to show it on television, to show it on YouTube, Facebook Live, you need help. And anybody that participates and watch something like that, you need help too. Mental illness is running rampant in America. America is full of crazy people. You know, people that are not in recovery, I should say. That are, they crazy and don't even know they crazy. Okay, it's one thing to be, know that you got some shortcomings and some issues like we all have. But we are on the path to trying to deliver and enlighten and better ourselves. But when you fools are running around here thinking ain't nothing wrong with you, and you participate in stuff like that, or you think that's funny or that's a game, you are a psychopath. Irregardless of your color, I could care less, your creed or any of that. And guess what? I'll be doing working overtime to get your ass up out the community by any means necessary. And I know I've digressed, but I had to get that off. Okay? Well, I'm going to go now. I had to get this video out because this frustration today. If you like what you hear, please share my video, like, and subscribe. I appreciate you all being out there, my wonderful YouTube subscribers. And I'm going to see you next time right here in the mental house. All right. Bye-bye.